All right. I think we have to begin the talk now because, for one, some of us are joining us from international locations and it's late for them. And two, because we have a packed program, we have two presentations we have to begin so that we can have enough time for the talks to continue. Please mute yourselves. Yeah. So today I'm really, really very excited to have this presentation happening. And it's a privilege, by the way, for us at the African Studies Center to have the connections and relationships with the people that are either scholars to MSU, visitors, students, faculty, members of the community that have agreed to share their time to be part of our programs at the African Studies Center, especially I'll speak for myself at the tea time. It's been wonderful, really, being able to engage members from diverse places with different experiences and knowledge and expertise in our tea time event. And we do cover various topics and that focus on different aspects of Africa. And today we're going to focus on one of those, and that is a discussion that is going to be on conflict management and peace building. I'm really very happy and privileged to have two wonderful young people from the continent of Africa, from the countries of Nigeria and Uganda. Please let's mute ourselves. I'll do that after the
Hey,
introduction.
Sandra, in the morning.
Sandra here.
All right. So at this time, I want to introduce to you the speakers that we are going to have for today. And it's two of them, as I've already mentioned. The first speaker is going to be Chibuzor Agomuoh. And Chibuzor has been to MSU before and has presented at tea time before. And we're happy to welcome him back. And this time, he's going to, as I said, speak from his experience on peace building and conflict management. So briefly about Chibuzor, he's a soft skills development consultant supporting leaders in corporations and communities to lead with head and heart skills. Author, he's also an author and specialist community engagement exchange program. He has implemented projects in various countries, including Ethiopia, Nigeria, The Gambia, Madagascar, and the United States. And his book, Rising at Sunrise, is currently read in over 21 countries. And the last time he spoke, or we had a book talk of this book, Rising at Sunrise. If you want to learn more about the book and the work that is included in that piece of writing, please go to our YouTube channel. And that was in 2022, if I'm not wrong. And you can check out, it's called Rising in Sunrise. That's the topic that we gave the presentation. So thank you very much, Chibuzor, for accepting to come back again and discuss this topic with us. Our second speaker is Gerald Bareke. Gerald, I hope I'm saying your name, last name especially right. And Gerald is not also very new to MSU. In fact, even if he hasn't visited Michigan State University, but he was one of the participants in a program that I was a PI in, that was a partnership between the Michigan State University African Studies Center and a funded project by the Alliance of African Partnership to conduct workshop programs and other trainings. And Gerald happened to be one of the participants in the youth sessions that were part of that grant or that workshop. So that's how I got to connect with Gerald. And I'm happy that today we have an opportunity to have him be part of the discussion today and actually be one of the leaders of the discussion. Thank you, Gerald. Nice to finally meet you. And we're looking forward to the discussion that we're going to have today. So, in terms of the order of presentations, we're going to have Chibuzor go first, and he's going to show, we are going to show his about 27-minute documentary that is titled Wise as a Serpent, Harmless as a Dove. After that, Chibuzor can talk more about that documentary, how he, the motivation, I would say, behind doing it. And then we can engage him in a discussion for around 30 minutes or so. And then we can delve into Geraldine's talk. So at this time, I want to go ahead and play the... Give me a moment here. Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and play the my screen, and it's shared already. We'll have to listen, please, and then after that, we can get onto the discussion.
There seemed to be a wide contrast between the serpent and the dove. The serpent, wild, adaptable, patient, mesmerizing, audacious, but definitely not the best pet for most people. The dove, beautiful, calm, gentle, a global symbol of peace. In the context of conflict management, we will be exploring this ancient statement found in Matthew 10:16, be wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove. At first glance, this statement seems like an impossible paradox, but as we patiently unpack it, we'll discover practical tools to managing situations of conflict. My name is Chibuzor Agomuoh. Join me on this expedition.
Me, I no be gentleman like that. I be Africa man, original.
I don't be gentleman at all.
I be Africa man, original.
I don't be gentleman at all.
I set out to have conversations with a pastor and leadership consultant, a youth development professional, a zonal manager at one of Nigeria's leading banks, a martial arts instructor, and a septuagenarian who has had decades of experience as an administrator, educator, and politician. Interpersonal relationships in its different forms often experiences the drizzles and thunderstorms of conflict. It's usually an uncomfortable situation to be in. What can the wisdom of the serpent and the gentleness of the dove teach us? I had a very interesting conversation with Pastor Kelechi Chibuzor. Pastor Kelechi leads the Insight Bible Church in Calabar. He holds a master's degree in world religion. I almost got carried away with the many questions I had that I forgot we were recording. He had some brilliant insights to share.
Yes, relevant, very, very relevant. First, we need to understand that symbolism there,
yeah.
Wise as a serpent, harmless as a dove. So that's Jesus using symbols to communicate truth. Generally, especially around this part of the world, very few people value snakes for any reason. Every snake is already guilty. So the natural reaction of people around here is, if it's a snake or looks like one, kill it. Kill it. So, I guess it wouldn't have been very different from the culture in which Jesus lived. To get people to see in that which is seen as dangerous, bad, poisonous, right? To be able to derive positive qualities in itself is already skillful life management. So Jesus talked about the wisdom of the serpent. So there is room for intelligence, there is room for knowledge, there is room for wisdom. But places of wisdom and intelligence are also often places of great wickedness. great insensitivity sometimes. And Jesus said, be wise as a serpent. But then the flip side of it, be harmless as a dove. So this is talking about wisdom and innocence. And it is necessary to be able to see positive things in people, in situations that do not naturally look friendly, and yet at the same time, necessary to retain innocence, even in the midst of, you know, wisdom and intelligence.
Recently, I have been studying a book by Dr. Deidre Combs. It's titled Worst Enemy, Best Teacher. Sounds interesting, doesn't it? Chapter 1 has this heading, See Your Enemy as a Teacher. And boy, oh boy, that's an uphill task. I've come to realize that a lot of persons find it difficult to navigate situations of conflict with tact because they lack basic soft skills. Soft skills such as communication, adaptability, empathy, inclusiveness, collaboration. This is oftentimes not taught in school. Mrs. Anne Mesembe is the director of the American Space in Calabar. I sat with her to unravel her experiences partnering with dozens and hundreds of organizations over the years. I was also interested in the relevance of soft skills in conflict management and youth development.
Yeah, soft skill management is really important when it comes to leadership. You know, having to work with young persons, we are looking at grooming the next level of leaders. So for them to be able to put up their best foot forward, they ultimately need to understand that they need to learn the basic skills that is required to help them, you know, navigate all of these processes, especially when it comes to conflict management. Definitely, when you have one or two or three persons, there is bound to be conflict. So, but the thing is, how best can you help to manage conflict? So that comes to understanding the place of soft skills. So, and that's why from American Spaces Nigeria, we have thought it necessary to actually bring together some kind of program to help young persons learn the basic soft skills that they need. So like this interview is timely because from Monday, which is September 18th, we have a 7-week long program for just young persons to learn about soft skills.
It is one thing to graduate from university with a degree. It is another thing to graduate with a comported mind. As a young person, if you get into the workplace without being able to manage your emotions, best believe that customers, co-workers, or your supervisors may help you shred it in pieces. If you fail to build soft skills, you can as well find a new career in unemployment. I wanted to speak with someone who has had many years of experience interfacing with customers and recruiting new employees. Mr. Charles Emefiele is a zonal manager in one of Nigeria's leading banks.
Okay, thank you so much for having me. I consider it a real honor. When you look at that scripture you mentioned, be wise as a serpent. In the corporate world, you need wisdom. You need wisdom. Been in the financial industry for about 24 years now. You meet all sorts of people. A lot of people transfer aggression. The things are really difficult in our climb. Things are hard. And people have issues at home, personal issues, and they are convoluted in their persons. And they come to you in the bank and you see a transfer of aggression. It's not really because of you, but something has happened in the background and you are the one facing them now. So you are bearing the brunt, you know, of their anger. So at that point, they transfer their conflict to you. So you require wisdom. You can achieve two things. You can, one, calm them down. you can address their concerns, and at the end of the day, they can leave your place happy. I used to work for a certain financial organization, and the slogan is happy customer, happy bank. Mm. Happy customer, happy bank. And that was what was ingrained into us. That is, no matter who comes in, into your institution, who comes into your banking hall, that person should live happy. Yes, and to achieve that, you need that wisdom. And then, of course, you are harmless. You are not using any tools. It's just your nature, the way you have been trained. So that's what we're trying to do.
So I decided to meet with a martial arts instructor. Watching Jet Li and Jackie Chan during my younger years, I wanted to learn martial arts so I could destroy all my bullies and haters in school. I thought learning karate and aikido would make me a street fighter extraordinaire. Thank God that warped mindset didn't last for long. Maybe I would have had a career in jail. Mr. Fonime has been a martial arts instructor for over 10 years. I learned something new for the first time, that the word karate is gotten from the Japanese words kara and te, meaning empty hands. Sounds more like being harmless as a dove.
The Japanese are very cultured nation. What I mean by that is that they don't easily get provoked. They are very disciplined people. You know, like for example, now maybe you go to a Japanese person's house. I don't want to bring it. I will get back to that question. Yeah. You don't wear slippers in a Japanese person's house. Yeah. You keep your slippers. I even have slippers for you to show how disciplined they are. And karate in time past was deadly, because then it was the time of war. People were using it to actually defend themselves. So the people did not really have weapons. So what were they really hoping on was just the skill that they have. So they use their bare hands. The bare hands were their weapon, what they used to defend themselves, what they used to do, anything they were doing. That's why if we look into karate katas, katas means form. You have to, it's actually divided into two sections, half kata, half kumite. The word kumite means fighting or free sparring. The word kata means demonstration or forms, like you do something that you do without fighting somebody. So the forms actually give you an intel of what you're doing when somebody attack you, or when you are in danger, what you need to do. So now, the kara and the te is this. Every karate student needs to know one thing. Karate is not meant for you to use for violence. It's very important. So once you get into karate class, the first thing first, they tell you, you're not using it to fight. Then the second thing they will teach you now is the dojo code or the karate pledge. He said, I shall strive for the perfection of character. I shall defend the path of truth. I shall foster the spirit of effort. I shall put up etiquette. And the last one said, and I shall guard against impetuous courage. Meaning that whatever you're doing, you have to be around the karate circle. Your instructors is number one thing. The one thing that a lot of people don't know, the six belt in karate, the six uniform, then they do it in military. So martial is like a military art. Now listen, how is it like? If you watch the police now, when you're fine, or when you go out of point in police or in military, they now remove your uniform. I said, your belt. Something happened to you in karate. If I remember, they said not to fight. He now went and fight in school and then. We call the karate dojo. The dojo means what, a karate training ground or a hall. They will ask what happened. And I explained. He said, you know the rules. They was down, say you stand up, you take your belt away from your belt, from your waist. And they can even demote you. You wear black belt, and then take it back to brown belt. With that in mind, once you step out outside to the wall, outside in your compound, anything happens around that compound, you know that, whoa, I have to be careful where I'm acting. Yeah. One, you're the art ambassador. Then two, you are the conflict ambassador. What I mean by that is that when something happens, people rush to you. Like in my compound, I said, they're fighting, like if I see them, I'm the one with the gun, but I'm not the one with the gun. You know that, once people see you, they will just, people will come, they will just say, okay, it's not like that. It's that years of training, years of understanding the art makes you to actually intervene in terms of issues. What I mean by that is that something happened now. A man looking at it, you can now diffuse it. You don't need to start. We don't shout. You don't show off. People think you show off. You're not showing off. You know what to do immediately. When something takes place, you know what to do. So now the question was that the cry and the tear, the empty hand means that whatever happens around you, you as a person have the power and the authority and the skill to actually diffuse any issue.
I've come to realize that one of the biggest lessons of karate and aikido is not the skill of incapacitating your enemy. It is the lesson of restraint, maintaining inner calm while being faced with a triggering situation. It is a mindset that says, I know I have the leverage to destroy you in a second, but I won't use it because it won't give me the best result. The best result is to win your heart. The worst result is to break your body. In situations of conflict, anger is oftentimes our greatest undoing. When we give in to the leadership of our anger, the results can be very regrettable and devastating. Many have lost so much because they took the route of anger. The destruction is often irreparable. I spoke with Mrs. Gifty Basiduke. She has had decades of experience in leadership, and she shares with us an interesting perspective to anger.
It's natural at any point in time for a human being to be unhappy about something, because actually anger is an expression of displeasure. But there are certain things you must consider if you are to express your anger. First of all, is what will be the outcome of my style of expression of my anger. Will it be beneficial to me and to the person who is angry with me, or will I actually be burning my fingers? So you have to learn to manage the anger. First of all, you have to, who is the subject of this anger? Two, who is the object of this anger, and what's the reason for the anger? So if a baby soils himself and I'm not happy, will I carry a sledgehammer and hit the baby? I will kill the baby. So we have to consider that. Now, the subject of the anger is the person who's offended. The object is the offender. So the subject, they have three different temperaments. The one who is quick to anger, then the one who is hot-tempered, that is, he reacts very violently. He may not get angry easily, but when he is angry, he's hot-tempered. Then there's the one that is slow to anger. The first two scenarios robs you of your senses. If you're quick-tempered, if you're hot-tempered. But the person who is slow to get angry has time to process and then to know this is the best way to handle my anger. So once I was reported to my superior boss, I had two bosses, so the first, the second level boss, and I didn't do that thing. I tried to analyze what I would say. I knew that head or tail, I would lose. Yes, but I didn't do that thing. But I knew that in the circumstance, head or tail, I would lose. If I tried to go and excuse myself, absolve myself. So between that time, I had to go to my second superior. What came to my mind is that the answer to every accusation is, I'm sorry. If you do that, you will return fast to your office. So I got there. My superior was ranting. You did this. You are casting aspersion. As he finishes a sentence, I will just say, I'm sorry, sir. I'll just say, I'm sorry, sir. And then when I said like three, four, I'm sorry, sir, He just looked at me and said, "Madam, you can go." So, but if I were going to prove myself, there'll be witnesses called. And that will prolong. And in the end, I will not win. I just saw that I wasn't going to win. Another thing is that when you are angry, especially in an official setting, there are laid down procedures. There are laid down procedures, disciplinary measures to be applied. If as a boss, your subordinate annoys you and you slap the person, nobody will remember the error of your subordinate. It's your misdemeanor that will be highlighted, because there you can use your office, the panathenemia of your office, to deal with a dispute, and then you come out clean. And then the correction or the peace that you want can be achieved. So we should not use emotions or how we feel to resolve issues and case. And you must not always win. You must not always win. That's why they say, you win some, you lose some, then there'll be peace. In the end, somehow the thing turns around in your favor. You gain more respect when you handle conflict in a proper way. There'll be reference to you. When there are other conflict situations, you may even be invited to handle bigger ones because of that.
Anger tends to make us suspend reason. So when you are angry, you are not likely engaging your best understanding or knowledge. Reason is often suspended when anger takes the driver's seat. The other part, the second thing, is that anger often makes us do things that are regrettable. Things we often get back to think about, to reflect on, and we say, "I wish I hadn't said that or done that." So it is important that we learn to manage our anger. We learn to stop. We learn to, sometimes it's as simple as taking a moment's pause before you say the next thing. It's as simple as breathing in and breathing out before you take the next action. But we need to manage our anger. Once we do that, we find that we are able to reason better, and the resulting actions would always be better than the ones taken in the heat of anger. So yes, we need to manage our anger.
This reminds me of a page in my book, Rising at Sunrise, page 101 on empathy. It shares with us something very interesting about empathy and human relations, and it reads, "Empathy gives us insight into the complexities of human nature. Moreover, it allows us to engage properly with those complexities, even when they are not in any way similar to our lived experience. With empathy, we are both blessed and burdened with the responsibility of tolerance, an inability to see the world through a different set of lens can further stifle one's ability to build healthy relationships. We must recognize that human beings are multidimensional. Thus, we shouldn't tackle social situations with a one-dimensional approach. Empathy invites us to bear in mind the varied viewpoints held by different people in different situations. Having said all that, I want you to understand that empathy is not about people pleasing. Being kind does not mean letting people use you. It takes a healthy level of emotional intelligence to tell when an action is a mistake and when someone is purposefully crossing the line. You need to learn to become comfortable with setting healthy boundaries in your life. If you fail to set boundaries, you're inviting people to ignore your needs while you stay busy catering to theirs. It's okay to express your displeasure when you feel underappreciated. You don't have to be vociferous about it. You can express your observations gracefully, but firmly. What a lot of people do is cower in humility outwardly, but stew in resentment and disappointment inwardly. Allowing such feelings of disappointment fester could turn your heart into a repository of anger, anxiety, and offense. You need to teach people to treat you as one deserving of respect. Remember, how can you love others when you cannot love yourself? Things become less complicated when we change our perspective. Our unpleasant experience with that annoying in-law or co-worker could be a learning opportunity for us to evolve. Many times, conflict, when mismanaged, increases the vulnerability of our strength and exposes the loopholes and weak links we never knew existed. And it becomes possible to be brought down by the conflict with the enabling of our lack of empathy, uncontrolled anger, and poor communication.
I don't want peace. I want problems always.
Well, remember that you do not have the monopoly of violence. If you use it on them, they'll find a way to fiercely use it on you. Like the dove, when we chose to be harmless, when we chose the way of peace, we chose life, we chose contentment, we chose true happiness. That's the way to inner fulfillment and harmony. It's a dangerous world out there. And so I charge you, be wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove.
Thank you so much, everybody, for watching and listening. And thank you, Chibuzor, for giving us a treat from different people with different experiences, with different ways of understanding on how to approach conflicting situations. And I think I don't want to talk further before asking you to first, you didn't have a chance to introduce yourself a little bit. And then the question will be, tell us more about why this film, why did you decide to do this documentary? So please just tell us a little bit more about yourself. I know I read a little bit, but who are you and why this documentary?
Thank you so much, Dr. Chotti. So I am Chibuzor Agomuoh. I am a soft skills development professional. I have been working with young people for over 10 years, both in Nigeria and in different countries. And one of the things that really motivated me to take up this project is the questions I've been getting from young persons each time I have trainings. And one of the things that triggered many of those questions is my book, Rising at Sunrise. So we get to talk about interpersonal relationships. And some of the challenges that come up, you know, from time to time. And conflict is usually one of those challenges. Questions about how do I navigate this situation in the workplace? How do I navigate this situation in my family? How do I navigate this situation in XYZ situation? So I decided to say, okay, it's important I develop a very simple approach. It doesn't look like a technical or very academic approach. But I decided to say, okay, let me pick up a very familiar statement that was said thousands of years ago, and let's explore it and see how it can help us help expand our understanding on managing situations of conflict. Be wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove. How can we explore that statement in the context of conflict management? And so I said, okay, let me create this documentary. Understanding that young persons were in the age of social media and audiovisuals. And some of the persons I had intended to, you know, get their perspectives. These are persons that maybe ordinarily I can't bring them to a workshop. So I said, okay, let me create a documentary where I can sample, travel to their locations and sample their opinions. There are five different persons there in the documentary. We have someone who is a religious leader and also a leadership consultant. He has a master's degree in world religion. And then there's someone else who has, who is a youth development professional, has had years working with organizations. We have someone else who is a manager in one of Nigeria's leading banks. I wanted to explore different perspectives, a septuagenarian who has been in politics for decades and administration, and then also a martial arts instructor. So I just wanted to sample the opinions of these different individuals from their different sector. As we explore that statement, what does it mean to be wise as a serpent and at the same time harmless as a dove? So it's been a learning experience for me. And recently I have been trying to explore the aspect of trauma-informed leadership. Mrs. Vivian was involved in a recent project. She was sending me a message via the chats privately that she might log off soon, because right now I think it's 10 p.m. in Nigeria. So I can understand that it's really, really late. But in recent times, I was able, after this project, I was able to develop another project still in the context of conflict management. And Mrs. Vivian opened my eyes a lot. Interestingly, Mrs. Vivian was the editor of my book, Rising at Sunrise. So in my career journey, she has been very much supportive. She's a trauma healing coach. And she gave me very, very interesting insights on the role of trauma when it comes to conflict. I don't know if Mrs. Vivian is around. I would like her to say hello and just say something, maybe something short about, you know, just to lend texture to this, something short about trauma and how it can trigger conflict. Mrs. Vivian, are you there? I know it's late.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well, good afternoon, I think.
Yeah.
Hello, Dr. Cho.
Hello, how are you?
I'm good. How is it? How are you doing as well?
Doing well, thank you. Good to see you again, or to hear
thank
from you again.
Thank you. Yes, just to lend context to what Chibuzor says, you know, there's a thing by one Dr. Diane Landberg. She's one very well-known trauma mentor. And she said that today's, in the 21st century, trauma has become like one of the highest issues that have to be handled. And I do agree, because just looking around, you know, it's like we're in a century where it is just difficult even to be alive. You know, it's like there's stress all over. There's so much going on. People are going through things. You know, just the fact that, I mean, if we go back just a few years back in the year 2020, we all know there was like this worldwide thing that, I mean, it was traumatic for everybody. And when you see, you know, the thing with trauma is that some people think it have begun to look at it like a diagnostic category, which it is not. It is just an experience. It's just an experience, and everyone has experienced trauma or will experience trauma one way or the other. So it becomes important that each one of us become aware of trauma and then begin to build resilience around trauma and become, I think one way I would put it is to become safe spaces for other people, the people in our lives, you know, the people that we influence, the people that are in our circle, so that we become that safe space for them. So in doing that, it becomes easy for conflict to be managed, because then when we become a safe space for people, it is easy for us to, to handle conflicts, to manage conflicts in a better way. And, you know, this whole dream that we have about more peaceful communities, that we have about, you know, people living in peace, that becomes a possibility when this happens. Thank you.
Thank you, Vivian.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Vivian. Thank you so much. In a recent project I did, Mrs. Vivian's contribution was quite immense, because it was an eye-opening experience for me. Understanding the role of trauma, because many times we talk about conflict and we forget that there is the root of conflict. And many times that root is trauma. That root is trauma. People, certain misunderstandings arise, not necessarily because someone did something that was very violent, but someone did something and it became a trigger for this person, and then it escalated into something else. And so many times leading and engaging with people with a trauma-informed mindset helps us to see things for what it is. By that I mean it helps us not read, it helps our interpretation of situations and not be very offended. Rather, it enables us to hold space for people and to treat people with empathy and great understanding, because at the root of all of this in our human engagement, it is very, very important for us to have this understanding. You know, so the work I do with young people has primarily been about focusing on interpersonal relationships. Because we know that for conflict management, conflict resolution, peace building, we look at the broader aspects of it. You know, there is the technical aspect of it, you know, but my work has been about looking at the very simple aspects of it, our day-to-day experience. You know, how can we incorporate these things? What does it mean to express wisdom, to be wise as a serpent, and at the same time be harmless? I am wise and tactful in the way I engage with people, but at the same time, I am harmless. I'm not seeking to take undue advantage of people or hurt them. You know, so that was the brain behind the documentary.
All right, thank you. I mean, it was a wide question. I did ask a wide question, and it did require a broad answer. And thank you so much for doing that. And thanks, Vivian, for also adding into the response and the discussion. So I want to give this opportunity to anybody here on the call who has a question or a comment to make based on the documentary that we watched, or anything else out of the work that Chibuzor has done. I mean, it could be his book, something that he has mentioned about his book, or just the documentary that we watched. A question or comment before we can move on to Gerald. You're free to type your question in the chat. You're free to unmute yourself, raise your hand, and you can speak.
Okay, can I speak?
Yes, please, Gerald.
Okay, thank you so much, Doctor. Thank you so much for a good documentary. It's really educative. I come from a background where 75% of the total population are young people below the age of 25, of which out of 10 young people you meet, 8 of them are unemployed. In previous 3 years, one of the leading newspapers in Uganda made a research, and they found out that 14 million Ugandans are living with mental disorders. This is the country of over 45 million people. But you can imagine having 14 million people living with these disorders. And what brings most of them to fall in that category is the trauma we are talking about. Someone finishes university, excels well with first class, but he can't get a job anywhere. These are the people most during COVID-19, in most of the Kampala streets, you would find people speaking alone. Someone is moving, but he's jazzing within himself. And most of them, it takes time actually to get such lessons to learn actually about trauma and how they can move out of it. And that's why we have found actually most of the young people falling into the trap, falling into these issues that be happening, not just because they want, but just because the trauma, the anger is making them move fall into these traps. So the documentary really was so nice. I really like it. And it's the same work that actually we are doing here with young people. But what I can say, the struggle continues. We still need a lot and a lot of such sessions to make sure that actually we help these young ones that are living with trauma, especially these ones that are in rural areas. And with the increasing unemployment rate, the levels of trauma has increased, I can tell you, basing on the young people that we are working with. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yes, thank you, Gerald, for that. I mean, I like the way that this discussion is connecting trauma with conflict, because sometimes we don't think about it like that. We always tend to assess the situation the way we see it, the way we view it at that moment. But if we took a step back to think about what might be triggering this, because for sure there's a time that you can be in a conversation with somebody and then somehow you realize that there could be more. Their emotions could have something more in the background that you might not understand. So if we all thought about what if there's something else that I don't see right now, that this is a manifestation of something else that I don't understand or I don't know, then perhaps that will help us learn to respond to situations differently. And I think that's the whole idea of this documentary, kind of taking a step back and thinking, what is it that I don't know that I need to understand before I respond to the situation the way I found it or the way I see it. And thank you, Gerald, for that connection. That for sure, trauma is everywhere. Sometimes it's a spectrum. We tend to think that, oh, I've not been traumatized before. But for the most part, we don't even understand it's trauma, you know. But it's just a wide range of the experiences that can be causing some certain insecurity, some certain emotions in you that you don't even understand. So I would stop there, but I thought Jimmy had a hand up. Jimmy, did you want to say something? Oh, Jimmy already typed on there. Jimmy, do you want to go ahead or you typed your thoughts?
Yeah, let me use this opportunity to greet everyone and to thank Chibuzo for the amazing presentation. So my name is Jimmy. I'm a Michigan State University Humphrey Fellow, and I'm from Burundi. So as I was texting in the chat box, I have a question regarding on conflict management. So today we've been witnessing both internal and external conflicts across Africa. I mean, within countries or even between countries or in countries. So how can we, young African leaders, address those kind of conflicts since sometimes we are victims? And what should be our role in conflict management when it's it's like it's about countries or it's some internal conflicts within our respective communities. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Jimmy. I think in the course of this tea time, Gerald is going to lend texture to my answer. But here is what I would say in response to your question. One of the very important things young persons need to manage conflict is to learn soft skills. Soft skills, at the heart of conflict is a deficit in soft skills. Some persons call it power skills. You could call it interpersonal skills. But at the heart of conflict is a deficit in soft skills. And some of these soft skills are communication, collaboration, empathy, adaptability, resilience, inclusiveness, problem solving skills, and critical thinking skills. So especially communication, for example, we've seen, you know, even at the basic primary level of the family, relationships between siblings, relationship between spouses, you know, how a situation can grow into a mountain just because someone misspoke or someone wasn't able to communicate effectively. We see that happen time and time again. You know, the presentation was poor, there was maybe little to zero active listening, and maybe there was also little to zero understanding of the individual or the audience you're engaging with. So we see that these skills are very important, even in the workplace, because right now I'm focusing on conflict management in the workplace. How can we manage situations of conflict in the workplace? Also considering the different dynamics between employees and their bosses, or between co-workers and, you know, what have you. So soft skills are the basics. You know, soft skills are the basics. If we are also able to know how to adapt, you know, understanding people's temperaments and knowing how to adapt in our relationship with them, that also helps. Because I say this time and time again, it is important that you understand the temperaments of the people you are working with, you know, of the people you are working with, especially your people in the workplace or family members. So that is very, very essential. Soft skills is very essential. And I would also recommend anyone that is interested to do some study on trauma. If you don't know much about trauma, I would encourage you to, you know, meet someone. For example, Mrs. Vivian is an expert. She's been doing this for years. And in the last session she held in Nigeria, while I was in Nigeria, I learned so much. I learned so much from that session and from the feedback we got from the participants of the program. Many of them expressed that truly the session helped them. Because one thing about this session on trauma is that it gives you a holistic understanding or a 360 degree view, understanding of the situation and the people involved, including yourself. Because sometimes we could be responding to a situation from through the lens of trauma. Many times I have also been guilty of that. And I now see that sometimes, okay, for example, there was something that happened in, I'm going to use myself as an example, and I am not ashamed to do that. Sometime in 2020, during COVID, I was in a team, we were working together on a project. I was leading that project in a sense, and there was someone who was to finance it. So along the line, there was something that was expected, because for me, I'm a protocol person. We do this, you do this. We do that, we do that. At this, you know, at specific times. And so we're expecting this other person to come to fulfill their terms by providing this document, doing this, doing that, doing that. And they were not really showing, being available or responding as I wanted them to. Now, there would have been a better approach to handle that situation. But honestly, I took a route that wasn't wise. You know, I was angry. I was like, I'm working with a team. You're supposed to do this at this time. You know, it was later on I got to understand that this person was dealing with something privately that kind of like took his attention away from the project, and he needed to deal with this situation privately. But for me, from my own end, I wasn't having it at all. And I responded the way I responded. And of course, it caused a trigger to, you know, with the other person. And boom, it has escalated into something. And that was how that project ended. But then with the benefit of hindsight, I was able to see that this was not how. And actually, I now realize that my response was a trigger. You know, the person's delay in responding as it should triggered me, because I had been in a situation before and a couple of times, and these individuals messed up the process. And this time I'm like, no, this rubbish is not going to happen. So it was a trigger, and I didn't really know how to manage that situation. So that lesson on trauma was able to help me tremendously, and was also able to help me, because I would call it trauma-informed leadership, to help me lead people through this, with this lens, understanding that sometimes the people you're leading respond a certain way because of trauma that they have experienced, and that I should be able to treat people with a certain level of grace, you know, and understanding. So I would encourage people not just to learn about soft skills, but also to learn about trauma, maybe not in-depthly, but just have an understanding. It would really, really inform our style of leadership, you know. So, yeah, that's what I would say in response to that.
Now, thank you, Chibuzor, for that elaborate response. I saw a question here. Where can I access the documentary to watch after the meeting? I think, Chibuzor, you can respond to that quickly.
Yes, so we recently uploaded an updated version of the documentary, and we made it private. But Dr. Chotti is at liberty to share the link after this session, yeah, to anyone who would be interested.
Oh, okay. So, Jivan, I'll be happy to share that with you and maybe to everybody that is in this call. Okay, thank you. Just to get back a little bit to what Vivian has said here, helpful to navigate situations where we sense there might be more to the responses we're getting in is asking the right question. Yes, most times we ask the question, what's wrong with you? I mean, if somebody asks you what's wrong with you, you already know there's trouble. You already know that they're agitated, they're aggravated. The better and more empathetic question is, what happened to you? Wow, that's wonderful. I've learned a new thing today. It's not that I wouldn't think that's the way to approach a situation like that, but thank you for giving us even the question to ask, the right question to ask in a situation where you think it might escalate, you're escalating conflict. Just ask what happened to you, which means you care about their feelings, you care about their emotions, and then you want to listen more to them.
Yeah.
All right. So thank you. I know perhaps somebody else might have a question for Chibuzor. Please hang on to it. Don't forget what you wanted to ask. Put it down somewhere. But right now, I want us to move on to the next presentation. And that is being done by Gerald. Gerald is the founder and co-director of Peace Builders Coalition in Uganda. And I don't want to introduce you more, Gerald. Please take this time to tell us more about yourself. And after the presentation, I'm going to ask the same question. Perhaps it's going to be answered before you even present. Why are you part of this organization? So, but for right now, please introduce yourself a little more, and then you can take us through the presentation.
Okay, thank you, Doctor. Thank you, Chibuzor, and everyone for this discussion. First and foremost, my name is Gerard Bareche, and I do work with Peace Builders Coalition. At Peace Builders Coalition, we envision an inclusive, peaceful world. We are a group of young people and we do peace building work here in Uganda. This is the work that I began when I was still at the university, the Makerere University, from 2020. I finished the first degree in 2021. But since then, we have been doing this work together with my group, because we founded this organization with five people, of which two were males and three females. And we have moved this journey up to this time when we still enlarging our scope of work. Personally, I'm a peace builder. I've done peace building work, both from local to global levels. I'm a researcher. I've done research, especially in peace building and environmental conservation. I've also written a lot. I like writing. I've written a lot about some of the issues that are happening actually in Uganda and across other countries, especially the areas of environment, peace, and agriculture. And I've also been a national coordinator for Young Peace Builders Uganda, which is under Coalition for Action on 1325, where I've been representing over 10 youth-led organizations that are part of the advocacy for youth peace and security agenda. Other than that, briefly, I'm also an award winner for Energy Resilience Awards 2023, where I was part of the seven young Africans that won this award because of coming out to speak about the issues that are happening in areas of peace and involvement, in general, the, coming out to speak about the poly crisis aspect, and many other things that I've done, which I'm going to present with you. Specifically for this talk, I want to share about our journey as Peace Builders Coalition, how what we are doing, how we have been able to do what we are doing, if there are areas of collaboration, if there are opportunities, and then we go deep into the discussion. Hope I can now enter the discussion, if Doctor, you allow me.
Yes, please go ahead. Thank you. Do you mind making it a full screen, or is it
on? Yes. Yes, I'm going to do it.
Okay. Like maybe you hit a slideshow.
Yeah.
Or it's just okay. I mean, we can see it. It's fine. It's visible. You can go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now I began with this picture to just show how I came actually in contact with what is happening here in this discussion. As Dr. said, I was part of the fellows that were trained, the workshop that was on diversity and inclusion, which happened here in Uganda, in Kampala, with MFI. And that's how I actually came into to know about the Michigan University and what they do. And this gave me a background of actually coming to be part of such discussions, because haven't it been these previous events? I don't think even the doctor and others would actually identify me as one of the people that are doing such work. So that's why I had to first put it on the first page to actually show the people that are following, the people that are on this chat, that actually I'm also part of the fellows, of which I think it's a journey that we have to move together. As Peace Builders Coalition, our mission is to empower communities, particularly youth and women, take up responsibility for their peace in Uganda and across the world. As I said from the beginning, we envision an inclusive, peaceful world. I don't know when we are going to achieve it, but we feel like as young people, we have power, we are courageous, and we can actually build this inclusive, peaceful world, where everyone's opinion is valued, where everyone sits at decision-making table, and where everyone has space and freedom of speech. At Peace Builders Coalition, we have our slogan, which begins, peace begins with me. So you as a person, if you are not peaceful, there is no way how you can challenge any person that actually you are a peace builder. So you yourself, you have to be peaceful before you actually do any other thing. So it's a slogan that we use in most of our work, and we make it be on forefront in everything we'll be doing. At Peace Builders, we do work in different areas. One, we do work in waste management and environmental restoration. This is where we mobilize young people to take part in environmental conservation measures. We mobilize communities. Here in the picture, you can see it's a group of young people where we had gone to launch a waste management campaign in one of the districts in Uganda. And these are some of the things that actually we feel that young people should wake up and be part of them to make sure we live in peace, because there is no how you can attain peace when the environment is being destroyed, when the wastes are being littered anywhere. So we try to make sure that we bring young people to be the agents of their communities and do and make sure that these societies actually live in peace. We do work in peace building as the COA. My colleague hit about it, but here we have a program which we run as Youth for Peace, where we do organize most of the events with communities. And in the picture, we had a meeting with the team from UNOI. And those who know the GNWP, in the picture, if you have been champion of Youth Peace and Security, you should be knowing the lady in between called Katrina, who works with GNUWP. And these are the conversations that we are engaging at national and international levels to make sure that actually we build peace, and young people should be at the center of building this peace that we are advocating for. Secondly, as I said, that peace building is at the core of the work we do. We have found it the challenge to, if someone has spent 2 days minus eating, it becomes actually so hard for them to actually participate in these peace building activities. So we say to keep in touch, in contact with these people that we are working with, especially young people, we have to come in with some of the livelihood programs, and that's how the entrepreneurship part of it comes in. So as we build peace, we make sure that actually these people that we have trained, we leave them with some hands-on skills where they can actually earn income, where they can earn a livelihood. We majorly do this major on agriculture. We also have tailoring services and many other activities that we empower young people with. We do inclusive education, whereby we do career guidance in schools. Here in Uganda, there is increasing child marriage, and actually you find most, if 10 girls begin school, 6 of them are the ones that finish. So you can imagine where the 4 go. So we make sure that we go deep into these schools, we inspire them, we give them career guidance so that they can attain higher levels of learning. Apart from that, we also, those are the 4 programs that we as peace builders run. But as the part of implementation, there are some of the strategies that we use during our work, and some of them are the community engagements. Here in the picture, we had an engagement, a dialogue with leaders, where we had to bring in young people to dialogue with their leaders, and this was during the 2021 general elections. Those who are following Ugandan election, you know how hectic and chaotic that election was. So after we heard the dialogue, because we found out that actually the young people were the one on the forefront of violence, and we had to bring them closer to, with their leaders, because they had developed a war between the young people and their leaders. There were no engagement, the leaders wouldn't listen. So here we came in and organized this dialogue, and it actually yielded a lot of results. We use media whereby we go to radio stations to reach more coverage. As you can see here, it's one of the radio stations where we are talking about the youth peace and security agenda. Other strategies we use, because we believe that actually without even the resources, we can do our work. I'm a writer, and I feel like if we empower young people with skills, most of the information can go out. So we empower them with skills on how they can write newspaper opinion articles and get the information go out. Sometimes someone finishes school, but what he knows is just what he studied in school. But I think as a person, I got the chance to learn how to write when I was still at school. And by the time I finished, even the some of the government ministries were looking for me. We want to see this boy who writes these papers every time. So we empower them with these skills so that they can produce these documents, and they can use them actually to survive in outside world where the employment are few. But when you have any skill that you present, and we have trained over 300 young people, and they are really doing well advocating for peace. If you can see well, here I think I was writing about introduce peacebuilding education in schools, and it's the same thing that what Chibuzor was talking about, how we can sort of the increasing levels of trauma that we have, especially young, especially among young people. These are the things that should begin right away from education institutions, because if we introduce peace building education straight away from primary levels, by the time someone finishes ordinary level, they will be understanding what actually trauma is all about. But here you find even the people who have graduated, even the people who have jobs anyway, no one can actually understand that someone is living with trauma for 10 plus years. So here it's a campaign that we are running as an organization to make sure that actually the peace building education is integrated in education curriculum actually right away from primary levels. We do community walks, community runs, whereby, and as you can see, it's a we have been part of some project in Great Lakes region, which is Great Lakes Youth Network for Dialogue and Peace, a project that we are implementing in Great Lakes region. And here you can see we are in the DRC, that is the Democratic Republic of Congo, where we are actually celebrating the International Youth Day. Those are some of the strategies that we use. And I want to talk about the work that we have been able to do at the global levels. One is the project that is called Great Lakes Youth Network for Dialogue and Peace. This is the project that we ran in Great Lakes region from 2021, and it ended in last year in December. It's a project that brought together young people across the region. As you can know, Great Lakes region is the one of the regions that has experienced the most conflicts across the world. And as I talk now, there are many conflicts that are going on around. And I feel like these are the projects that we need to be engaging as young people to make sure that actually we challenge the status quo. Because if you read the history of Great Lakes region and you see the conflicts that has been happening, this is the region that has the highest population of young people. And this is the region where the young people are always on the forefront of these conflicts. So this is the program which brought together young people across the region to discuss actually on the strategies on how we can actually be the agents of peace in our respective countries. Secondly, we are part of the Youth Lab project, which is Cross Border Dialogue for Peace. I'm happy to see my comrade Jimmy. I think I worked with Jimmy on this project that we implemented in Great Lakes region, and it's getting to an end. It also brought together young people across the region to actually discuss and dialogue. You know, in Africa, dialogues are not always They don't always happen, however much we've been demanding for them, but we feel like young people, we can be the drivers. We can be the agents of creating such platforms where young people can meet with their leaders and dialogue. So it's a project that we have been running in the Great Lakes region, and we feel like these are the projects that have actually enabled the young people to come out and speak. These are the projects that have created platforms where we express our views as young people to make sure that they are integrated in the decision making. Some of the achievements or milestones as an organization that we have achieved, one, we have increased our partnerships from local to global levels. Here we work with, for example, the above projects and others. We work with GNWP, we work with UNOI, we have and many other platforms that we are part of. And this is just because of the base we have built in the 5 years that we have been in existence as young people and the work we have actually done on the ground. We are part of the working group that is drafting the National Action Plan on Youth Peace and Security. This is the UN resolution that came into place in 2015, and you're all aware that Uganda has no national action plan. And I think in Africa, there are, I think, three countries, I know Nigeria and DRC, that already have the national action plan. And we're saying that when we have this agenda, we shall use it as a vehicle that will actually bring together young people to advocate for peace building activities. So we are part of the secretariat that is under the Ministry of Gender, Labor and Social Development, where we are giving our views as young people, because this is the agenda that is going to affect us as young people, and we be in engagement to make sure that this national action plan comes in place. We are part of the founders of the African Youth Coalition for Peace and Development, and as currently we are the ones hosting it. This is the platform that brings actually Africa youth peace builders, especially those that have been part of the EU projects, where we meet and discuss on how we can actually build Africa to become peaceful. You know, the conflicts that are happening every day. So it's a coalition that actually we are looking at as one of the strongest coalitions that will actually lead most of the peace negotiations in Africa. We have established the spots for peace projects. This is something that is an innovation that the most organizations haven't embraced, but we found out the spots are one of the strategies that can bring out young people within the shortest period of time. So we have spread these campaigns across 23 districts in Uganda, and they are doing well. We are in 2021, we were accredited to observe the general elections. As you all are aware, what usually happens during elections. And even in 2026, we have already submitted our organization. And this is a milestone, it's an achievement to find that a youth-led organization that has been in existence for 5 years can be accredited actually to observe the national elections. We have built a movement of 270. Peace ambassadors. What I forgot to say, when we train young people, we give them the titles of peace ambassadors. So when we have activities in different districts, when we reach our peace ambassadors, be like our contact people. Actually, in our absence, the peace ambassadors do the work that we are supposed to be doing. So we so far have 270 well-trained peace ambassadors that are established in different districts of Uganda. We have supported registration of 7 community-based organizations. These are the young people, and we have found out if we were to help most of the young people, because most of them are not organized, most of them are disorganized. And even if you need to share opportunity, sometimes we don't have platform where to share these opportunities from. So we have supported 7 of them to register community-based organizations, where we pass through if we have any opportunity to share, and they are doing well in their communities. Where do we see the opportunities for collaboration? One, we need to collaborate through the media campaigns that be happening, the international global days that be celebrated. In this case, for example, the International Youth Day, where we can have the joint activities. We need to work in partnership. We need to share work-related opportunities. if there is an opportunity in area A or area B, we need to share, we need to follow one another on media pages, and we need to create a platform for continuous engagements. For example, this platform, these are the platforms that actually can act as the that can be learning classes, because I like, because in most of the events we learn and unlearn. And me meeting here my friends from Nigeria, my friends from all other countries, it gives me value to make sure that, because I know what now Chibuzor is doing in his country, he knows what I'm doing in Uganda. And at the end of the day, we connect and see how we can build a sustainable peace in Africa. Because if Nigeria is not peaceful, I don't think Uganda can be peaceful. If certain country is not peaceful, the whole continent don't be peaceful. Finally, some of the challenges, they are usual challenges, they will limited human and financial resources. Actually, most of what we have felt much is for the work we are doing, you find that if you have not connected with most of the big organizations, it actually becomes hard to get support. Because you find you'll be competing with a big organization that have been in existence for years. And when you haven't built yourselves, when you haven't stood on your values, it becomes so hard to actually be identified and also receive support to do the work we are doing. Because sometimes you find the work is too much. Sometimes we feel like we are doing a lot, because you find the concept of peace building is actually very new to most of the young people, especially in the Great Lakes region. When you are talking about peace, it takes time for actually young people to understand what peace is all about. And you find that the session that you are supposed to do within 1 hour or 3 hours, you spend the full day explaining what it means and how it can affect them. So we find that sometimes we are limited with resources, and that limits our scope of work. The limited exposure to some decision-making platforms, especially in Great Lakes region, I'm focusing on it because I've worked, I've been part of 3 projects in Great Lakes region. I've followed the proceedings. I've followed each and every administrative units in each country. And I found most of the young people actually don't sit on the decision-making tables. Even for the decision that affects them, someone sits behind and makes them. And this is why when it comes to implementation part, you find nothing has been done and you find everything is failing. The other thing that we are facing is during this work we are doing, young people are vulnerable. As they say that young people are vulnerable, I think it keeps on growing and growing. Sometime before even we invite some of the young people for the training, the first question is, what are you going to give us? Actually, someone's come with the mindset of, I'm going to get lunch from there. And when they reach, the whole mind remains on what time shall we get lunch? What time shall we get breakfast? And they lose focus on actually the subject of the matter. So we find it so problematic, but this is the situation that has been created, not only here in Uganda, but across many countries. Because you find people, young people unemployed, they spend the whole day on the streets. And when they get an opportunity actually to be mobilized, they feel like they should eat, they should do what. So we find it too much demanding and it costs us a lot. We also have less support of peace building activities by the authorities. Those, these are the things that actually the government should put focus on. You don't need to build a strong army, attain peace in your country. You just need to change the discipline, the mindset of the citizens. But the moment you put all emphasis on building a strong army, and you make the citizen not understand what actually conflict is, what actually peace is, you're also wasting time. So this is where we call on the government actually to come in and support this. That's where I go back to the campaign that we are running of introducing peace building education in schools. This is, there is no logic there, but you find it so hard to actually explain for some of the leaders to understand that actually when we begin these lessons in lower schools, these young people can grow up when they understand what actually peace is all about and they be ambassadors. Finally, these are some of the important quotes that I had to find out. Nothing can bring you peace but yourself. Yeah, yourself, if yourself you are not peaceful, I don't think something can be done for you to be peaceful. It is not enough to win a war. It is more important to organize the peace. The practice of forgiveness is our most important contribution to the healing of the world. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. If peace can only come through killing someone, then I don't want it. Thank you so much. Get back to you. Can follow us on our social media platforms, on our Twitter, on our Facebook, on our website. I thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, Gerald. This is a wonderful presentation, and thank you for sharing the work that you do. And I remember this presentation is titled Peacebuilding and Conflict Management, Bottom-Up Approach. And I know it's not easy. That's why in the first place I asked, why did you even decide to be part of this organization, or even to initiate this organization? And part of it you've answered, but I'm still going back to ask, you were in high school. What was really in you that made you feel like we need our young people to be part of the change that we want to see, especially the peace advocates, the champions of peace in our communities? And as you've explained, it's not easy at all, because it needs funds, it needs commitment, it needs even the explaining that you said, sometimes you have to do it over and over. And yeah. the question that they ask, what is in there for me? It's a genuine question, because there's so much that the youth need. There's lack of employment. There's so many needs that even keeping peace becomes secondary. So first, just thank you so much. That was very, very intense and eye-opening at the same time. So perhaps I can let you answer the question. I have so many things that I can ask about, and I don't want to do that because we have other people in the call. But as a high school student, what made you feel like you had a responsibility to start this organization or to be part of it?
Thank you so much. I think I was at the university level, some connection. I got an opportunity to apply for some boot camp, which was under Coalition for Action on 13/25. It's one of the peace-building organizations there in Uganda. And out of, they wanted 14 young people across the country, and I was part of them. So I got an opportunity to join that boot camp, which happened in western part of Uganda for a full week, which was all about peace-building for young people. So after the training, I got to be introduced about the conflict analysis, the conflict resolution, the mediation, and others. So after, we encouraged that actually for you guys to give contribution to your country, for you who have got an opportunity to be part of these trainings, you have to organize yourselves. So on how you can organize yourself, you have to register an organization. We are still at school and we didn't have any funds in place. But the knowledge we gained and the training we got forced actually us to register an organization, which is Peace Builders Coalition, as four people. And that's how it came into existence. Minus that, I was a very stubborn boy during Makerere University. And during elections, I would actually be on the forefront for anything happened, Gerard would go on the forefront. So I sat, and these are the things we do not sitting and evaluating what may happen after. Because most of the time we find ourselves in two traps, and we don't think actually before acting. So after basing on all that background, and having got just get introduced to such concepts, it quickly changed my mind. Actually focus on this work we are doing. So that's the brief background actually on how this organization came into place.
Thank you so much. It's amazing what education, like training, can do. It took the knowledge that you got from being part of that bootcamp to trigger your understanding of what you can do and how you can become a part of
building the peace that you want to see in communities, especially among young people, because I wouldn't call them troublemakers. I wouldn't say that they're the forefront of violence. It's just the circumstances, you know, that push them to look or even to be perceived as people who are always making trouble. But I'm glad that organizations like yours are really tackling that problem from the community level, because if, as you said, and I love that slogan, peace begins with you, begins with me. If I'm not peaceful, then nobody else will. So I would talk about this, but I want to give an opportunity for the people that are here now. I know you're headed to around midnight, or is it after midnight now?
Yeah, this side is already midnight, 1:30.
Oh my. Oh, okay. I'll allow people that are over here to comment, ask a question, just engage Gerald based on the discussion, the presentation that he has given, and then we can move on. Anybody that you can unmute yourself, you can type your question on the chat, you can raise your hand. Please feel free to be involved in the discussion. Any questions, comments? Oh, I see Jimmy here on the chat. Jimmy is saying, thank you so much, Brother Gerald. I'm so glad to attend this reunion, and it's a pleasure to learn more from you. Your work is inspiring, and I remember having met you in the same program, Youth Lab. Together, we have been attending trainings in Uganda, Burundi, Democratic Republic of Congo, and Rwanda. The world needs people like you. Well, that's encouraging. Thank you for the kind words to your colleague, Jimmy. Gerald, that's for you.
I think I got to know Jimmy too. 1 year back, we met, I think, in Burundi. We are part of one of the programs that is in Great Lakes region. And when we reached in that, we found ourselves actually at certain level compared to other participants. So it was quickly for me to connect with Jimmy, basing on the work that we are doing. Because as we are talking about the word peace, it is actually complex. And sometimes when we attend these events, you find that actually very few can actually understand what peace is all about. Yeah? And I found out that most of the time on the platforms, if I find there a colleague I know. Now, most of the time, I'm happy to see Chibuzor. Nowadays, I have most of my friends from Nigeria, of whom we are doing some work together. And this just comes out from such events that we are having here. And that's why I do encourage that let's have as many events as possible, because from any event, a lot is learned really. Thank you so much, Jimmy. And we still have a lot actually to do to change our region.
Yeah, I did meet with Jimmy the other day, and I was happy to learn that he knows you. He was sure he was going to be here. So thank you, Jimmy, for coming to support Gerald and to be part of this discussion today. I see Leo's hand up. Yes, please, Dr. Zulu. You can unmute yourself.
Okay, so thanks a lot for all the great work that you are doing and for sharing that work with us. I was just chatting yesterday. There's a colleague of mine. She has a genocide museum at the University of Northern Illinois. And again, we were chatting about, you know, many of the challenges about Africa and how to address them. And when you were speaking, it resonated with me, the idea about trauma and how a lot of people don't know about trauma. And what she was trying to emphasize is the need in Africa to heal, you know, to heal ourselves from this trauma, and how we've suffered lots of traumas from colonialism and all sorts of things. and that we neglect that part about ourselves, and then it's important to heal. And then I like how you are doing your work and spreading the word around about that. I don't know what you might say to a comment like that about your experiences about the need to heal and how important that is moving forward in African development and human welfare.
Thank you so much, Leo, for that comment. I think actually the healing should begin with the Africa heads of state. In most of the discussions I participate in, because the first thing I say is, let's be honest among ourselves. Yeah, sometimes the burden is put on uneducated people and unemployed people. And you find that those who are in position, they feel like they are always right at any time. One time I was doing a presentation on TV with one of the ministers, and he said something wrong. And I said, Honorable Minister, you are wrong. I said, should I correct you? But I can tell you that statement made me get suspended for some month for going back to the same station. So when you talk about the healing actually needs to begin. We are talking about the bottom-up approach. But here, I think the healing we should begin the top-bottom approach. Yeah, because you find most of the mistakes that are actually imposed on Africa, they are the leaders who are on the forefront. I want to give you an example, not going very far. We have one of our neighboring countries where the heads of state, if they are not in their moods, one of them crosses the border. And we spend like, this is the border where you can even drive and enter another country, which is actually in the same region called the Great Lakes region. And this is where the heads of state are actually advocating for the integration. But when you actually put most of them on hot seat, actually explain what integration is all about and how the Great Lakes region can attain it, you will never get a honest discussion. So we need to get this healing, and I still say that this healing, if the leaders embrace it, the same way the leaders have faith embrace dialogue as one way how we can build peace in our communities. If they still can't accept that actually they are living with trauma and they need to be healed, then we shall still live in the dilemma we are in. Thank you.
Thank you, Gerald, for that response. For you, it looks like the political leadership especially needs to be the gear or the steering towards the healing. And I want to invite Chibuzor, because Leo, before you joined, we in fact had a long discussion about what the relationship between trauma and conflict. So perhaps I can invite Chibuzor to give a comment, because that's part of the discussion that we really had before we invited Gerald.
Yes. So thank you so much, Dr. Choti. Yes, the relation or the connection between trauma and conflict. From my personal experience, I've seen that in many cases, trauma is an ingredient or a component in many conflict situations. And this is why I would always advise, for example, I'm in the process of contributing to a book that is written by a professor in South Florida University. It's a book on conflict management for nonprofit organizations. And I'm privileged to have my material approved to be on that book. So one of the things I talked about in the book is, exploring the structure and culture of an organization. You know, the culture there talks about the social climate of an organization. And this is why I would always recommend that every organization have a therapist or undergo therapy periodically, maybe once in a year? Because, you know, many times people have issues that they have bottled up in their hearts, and everything they do in that particular organization, in that particular setting is smeared by the trauma. So for example, I'm working with you, Dr. Chotti, and maybe in my previous workplace, I was traumatized. I'm bringing up a scenario. I was traumatized by my supervisor. He or she didn't treat me well, and I left that job. And now I'm working with you. Absolutely. And then you gave me, maybe on a certain day, you gave me an instruction with no mean intent, but maybe you told me, please ensure that the document is ready by 12 p.m. You said it from a place of urgency. And because I had been traumatized in my former place of work, that becomes a trigger. I begin to feel like, oh, she's putting me under pressure again to make sure the document is ready. And then the next thing, conversations begin to spring up in my head. Why is she making me feel uncomfortable? I don't like the way she's talking to me. Maybe she's a mean person. Maybe certain things start coming up in my head. And then all of those suggestions that are coming up in my head will now influence my reaction or my response to what you've said. And then from then on, before you know what is going on, resentment begins to build in and it escalates into something else. I've seen situations where someone joins a workplace and maybe there is a meeting, and all of a sudden they see a work colleague, someone across the desk. Maybe there was a non-verbal activity or response the person gave, which, I mean, there was no ill intent behind it, but that became a trigger for this other person. And then from then on, they begin to tell themselves, this person doesn't like me. I don't like this person. And then that becomes the beginning of issues in that organization. So, you know, trauma is a very important, a vital factor. And it's very important that people undergo therapy with the help of a therapist to help them process their emotions and help them process certain events they have undergone to help them heal and have better interpretations of those situations. You know, so one of the things I try to tell people when faced with someone who, maybe someone they've not met before and they are experiencing difficult situations with this individual, is to have a sit-down conversation, sometimes get to know this person and be polite in asking powerful questions. Now, I call them powerful questions because these questions will help you understand the other individual and will also help the other person process their emotions about you. So it's very important that if you're in a setting, in a work setting where you're working with people and you're not getting along, that you seek to have conversations with them, understand them better. It's in the process of understanding them better that you would know that, okay, this is this person's personality, or this is the reason why this person is responding this way. And that's where you find empathy. That's where you find empathy, putting yourself in the other person's shoes. It's a very complex topic, actually. You know, the connection between trauma and conflict is a complex topic that we really need to sit down and look at it closely and absorb some of these major components that would help us really, really connect with people and live a trauma, or maybe lead with trauma-informed sense or trauma-informed wisdom. You know, so that's what I would say basically.
That's really wonderful. Many things, sometimes we learn about new ideas or new knowledge as we go, because
I know there's conflict all the time. Let's think about these international conflicts. It's rarely that we come to think of them as what if we resolve the trauma part of it. And as I said, it's a spectrum. It can be major, it can be minor. But how about we look at these other multiple aspects that come into the situations that people live in? Like, trauma is not one thing that most of the time people talk about. They do when it's a conflict situation, and not situation per se, but region. For example, it's a major conflict. It's war. That's when people think about it. Oh, perhaps trauma contributes to this situation, this situation of conflict. But really, do we think about it as in a family level conflict, work level, you know, disagreement? We never think of it as, we never know the baggage behind the person that we see or we're talking with. So it's really important. I think I've learned today that it's not that, as I say, it's not that I'm not aware, but just kind of thinking around, what does trauma do in different levels, or trauma of different kinds do in the engagements that you have with people, the discussions that you have with people, the interactions that you have with people? What can that help? How can it help to factor in that you never know what somebody is experiencing? And yeah, out of that, rethink of what can a good response be in a situation like this. So I love the discussion. I love the direction that we're taking. I saw that Jimmy had his hand up. I don't know if you lowered it, Jimmy, before we give it to Dr. Kalumbu.
Yeah, thank you so much. While Gerard was presenting, there is this question, when we are talking about peace, sometimes as a young people, I was born in Burundi, in the most insecure province of Burundi. So I've been facing, let me say, civil wars, conflict, and so on. And so I'm not just coming here to talk about myself, but I really have this question: can we, or is it possible to achieve peace, for example, in the Great Lakes region? Since Gerard is from that region, and we've been having these, let me say, a non-stop discussions since, let me say, 3 decades or even 4, say, up to 6 after colonialism. We've been seeing these conflict, repetitive conflicts and wars. So today I'm asking, and I remember one day I've been thinking about this question. So if Gerard is very open to this question, or if anyone, because let me say, years and years are passing, and we are in the same situations, dreaming for change, dreaming for peace. So now my question is, can we keep advocating for peace, teaching people about peace, or maybe we can get aware of this and maybe start teaching people how to live in conflict zones, in conflict places, because sometimes we need to understand that if something is not changing, if something is not really changing, how can we live with it? Because, for example, in the Great Lakes region, recently, 2 decades ago, we were facing different the same problems, and today, that's what we are facing. And can we keep using the money of, I'm sorry to use this, wazungu, money from white people or international communities, just to say about peace, meetings, conferences? And the next time, as Gerard said, like the head of state and some people, they will say, hey, we don't want this and this, and there a conflict we arise again. So now, what can we do as young people? Can we live with this, or can we still talking about peace and dreaming for lasting peace? Thank you.
Thank you, Jimmy. Gerald, please, just about 2-3 minutes. We have 7 minutes to wrap up, so please.
Okay. Thank you, Jimmy. I've been part of peace building projects, three of them in Great Lakes region, and I've interacted with most of the young people there. But what I've found out, we ourselves, because one country is blaming the other, that for you, you are coming to our country, smuggle this. You are coming to our country, smuggle this. With this project that I've been part of, there are some countries that are actually not opening up to speak. You be in a meeting with 12 participants from certain country, but it's only one person who speaks. And after speaking in the evening, they have a meeting. If you spoke when they had not allowed you, you will have to explain. So I usually say that we young people, we are the majority with minority mentality. Because when you look into the Great Lakes region, over 70% are young people. When you look at the people that are being recruited into these rebel groups, they are young people. If you see the riots that happen on the streets, they are young people. Then you ask ourselves, or you ask yourself, can we build the peace we want? The answer is simple. If the Great Lakes leaders agree and sit on the round table and discuss to have peace in Great Lakes region, even tomorrow the Great Lakes region will be okay. But the moment we still have our leaders who cannot sit on the same table and dialogue and discuss, we still have a long way to go. Thank you.
Thank you, Gerald. I mean, I can understand sometimes it's very complex. Sometimes you want to sit and, you know, just give up. But the fact that you've not given up, however challenging it is, it's very good to know that as much as it's challenging, and even from your presentation, it's not easy. There's no, it's not usually that there's support, the support that you need to do the work that you do. There's no much collaboration, especially from the government part of it, but you're here, you show up, you do what you can do for your community. That's still something that we need to be applauding, because you're here to do the most that you can do for your community. So thank you. I know it's frustrating. It's really, sometimes you feel like, is there a point of me doing what I do? And that question, I think most of the time we all ask ourselves at some point, at some stage in our lives or at some stage in our work engagements, is it even necessary? Is it impactful? But I would say, yes, it is. However much sometimes we don't see. And Jimmy, yes, we'll keep doing it. It's sometimes change doesn't come tomorrow. Sometimes it takes a while, but we need to be doing the small piece that we're doing to, with hope that things will get better, because we're not sitting and watching. So, Dr. Kalungu.
Thank you, Damaris. I just had a quick question about children. Mm-hmm. You know that a lot of these conflicts involve children, and the trauma that children face is hard to detect because they may not articulate it as well as adults do. How are we dealing with that?
Gerald, do you want to handle that?
Thank you so much. Of course, I think what he said is a part of the campaigns that we as peace builders we are running across the country, which is all about integrating peace building education into the curriculum. This is where these young people can actually get an opportunity to learn what trauma is about, what conflict is all about. And these are the things that need to be integrated into the government system. But it is still taking us time to actually for these authorities to understand that we can use these education institutions as the vehicle, sort of all these issues that come that result into the conflicts. So I still believe that these young people can well be reached through education institutions, and the government should actually embrace these peace-building activities to happen in the schools and be integrated into the curriculum. And actually, they should be examined. How can we have an... Because like in Uganda, I usually refer to the history, we study the history of other countries, but Ugandan history is never taught. So instead of studying the history of other countries, why don't we introduce a concept or a subject on peace building so that these young people can actually understand what peace is all about? So I still believe that any change can begin from education institutions if we want to build the sustainable peace we want.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, Gerald, for that response. We have 1 minute, and I don't know if I should just go ahead and wrap up, but I think it's good to give Gerald and Chibuzor the, like, 2-3 seconds each to just wrap up before we close. Parting shot, anything that you would like to say before we close?
Okay.
Okay, so thank you so much, Dr. Chotty. I would encourage anybody listening to invest in soft skills development and also invest in understanding more about trauma, because that's the basics. And I hope that this conversation we've had would serve as an appetizer to encourage you to do in-depth study. This will help a lot in the way we engage with people in the future. So thank you so much, Dr. Chotty, for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Chibuzor and Gerald.
Thank you so much for this opportunity to be part of these discussions. I think one thing I usually tell the group I be dealing with, let's speak up. It doesn't matter the amount of results you achieve, but do what you are supposed to do during your time. It will be a shame when your children ask you, but what did you do during your time? So it doesn't matter the results you achieve if you are doing what you are supposed to be doing. I thank you so much for listening, and I call upon each and everyone, especially the so-called young people. They seem called vulnerable. We shouldn't be called vulnerable at any other time. Let's come out, let's rise up, let's speak up. We are many, let's use our numbers to determine the decision that happens across the Africa or across the world. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much. There's so much that we can say. I think even if you wanted to extend this discussion, we could, but let's close it here because of time. And thank you so much again, Gerald, for joining us this late hour of the morning. It's going to morning now. And thank you, Chibuzor, for coming back again to share your documentary. And as you said, I'm free to now. It's been private until today, but Chibuzor allowed me to share it with the public. So somebody can watch it here through this video, but still, like Jevan wanted to have a link to the recording. So I will share with you, Jevan. And if anybody else wants the link to that, I'll be happy to share. But this recording will be uploaded to our channel, the African Studies Center at Michigan State University. And even so, I will share with everybody. Once the link has been uploaded, I will share with, notify everybody that was in this call so that you can go view it, share with friends and colleagues that may have wanted to be here but didn't make it. Otherwise, thank you so much. Look forward to seeing you back again at the African Tea Time, Michigan State.